Hey everybody. So I know I didn't post, a lesson since yesterday morning. So this is today's lesson, Wednesday, August 19th. And we ended the last video that you saw just talking about the basics of civilization. Now we're actually going to get into one, the first, which of course was the Mesopotamian region. And like I said, I said this in class. I can't remember if I said it online, but you have the Mesopotamian region, but you have like the Sumerians and the Akkadians and the Babylonians and the Assyrians, and they are all within the Mesopotamian region, but yet their own empires. It's kind of like, you know, you're an American and a Texan. All of these people were Mesopotamian, but then also identifying, of course, within their empire as Sumerian, Akkadian, Babylonian, or Assyrian. So don't let that confuse you if, like, for whatever reason, I kind of toggle between, you know, using the two terms. So, of course, the single greatest thing that happened in all of human history, that was your bell ringer for today, is agriculture. It truly shifted the way that we operated. Without that, we would never have stopped hunting and gathering for food. Agriculture allowed for a reliable source of food, and just kind of recapping on a few things that are important. And then, of course, we also talked about the basics of civilization. You have your cities, your government, religion, social structures, writing, and art. Those are your six things that you really need to see in order to call something from the past a civilization. You have to see all of those things. So let's look at the first one, Sumeria, or Sumer, the Sumerians. Okay, as you can see right here on the map, they're right there in between the Tigris and Euphrates River within the Fertile Crescent. And they gave us the actual first writing system that we know of. Okay, it's Sumerian cuneiform, which to me just looks like a bunch of golf tees. But, the difference between cuneiform and hieroglyphics is, as you can see, the cuneiform is actually like the same symbol, just switched around, whereas hieroglyphics are actually like pictures, of course, that represent a lot more than maybe one word or one letter. So, there's a difference between a written language and then a pictorial language. And that's what hieroglyphics were. But Sumer is the first one. And of course, they were polytheistic. And we talked about how, of course, human beings do not like to feel out of control. We like to be able to explain our environments, right? And so, you know, and anything that we can't explain, then we have to create a narrative for it in order for us to feel in control. So the Sumerians, of course, were polytheistic. They had multiple gods, sun god, moon god, you know, thunder god, rain god, harvest god, whatever. And they built these stepped towers called ziggurats. And they're very similar to the temples that you see, in old Mexico, in Latin America, that like the Olmecs and the Aztec and the Mayans built. They're stepped pyramids instead of the smooth pyramids that you see later in Egypt. Although the first Egyptian pyramid was stepped. So anyways, you also, of course, have a government. And at the top of most governments at this point in time, your priests and priestesses really ran the show. And of course, it's because they're your direct way to please or displease the gods. And so that creates a lot of power within their positions. And so, you know, naturally, they lead. And, you know, how do you go from, you know, a village to a city state to an empire? Well, you get more territory. Y'all are going to hear me say this again and again and again this year. Land equals power. Okay? The more land you have, the more power you have, because the more people you have and the more resources you have. So for years, land will equal power. It's why people came to the United States, for goodness sake. I'm a poor Irish peasant back in Ireland, but in the New World, I can get some land and maybe be something more. And so land has always been the ticket to wealth and power. You know, so You know, there are ruins. There are Sumerian and Akkadian and Babylonian ruins. They're not as great or as vast as what we see in like Greece and Rome, but it's because they didn't have as good of material to work with. A lot of their cities were made out of like mud bricks. And, you know, mud bricks just don't stand the test of time like stone does and marble and all of those other things that the Greeks and the Romans had access to. Don't get me wrong, the Sumerians and the Akkadians and such, they had access to stone, but it was much more limited. They didn't have as many quarries. So, of course, we have our pyramid, our social structure pyramid. Y'all are going to see me doing this constantly, as I said. And it's because every single society is going to have one. Human beings naturally place themselves into a social structure with a leader at the top and then skilled followers underneath that. And I know you can't see it, but at the very bottom, again, unfortunately, since there have been people, there has been slavery. And there have been the powerful, suppressing the weak. And so it's no different at the very beginning in Sumerian society. You've got your priests at the top, your nobles at the top, you know, your more skilled set people more in the middle, and then your laborers, peasants, slaves, they're at the bottom. So how did they display the six characteristics? Well, they had large cities that expanded out and gained more territory. They had a set governmental system with priests and priestesses at the helm, they were leading. You know that there were religious connotations in their world because they built temples. And again, the priests and priestess are the leaders. You saw their social structure, but they also, of course, had cuneiform. They had a writing system, and they actually gave us the first story, which is the Epic of Gilgamesh. It's a crazy story. I actually challenge you to either go read parts of it or heck, maybe read all of it. Because it is an interesting read, I will tell you that. You'll think that you're in, it definitely reads as fiction, and you'll think you're in this like dream world where they're battling these weird monsters, and it's crazy. So very cool though. But in addition to the Epic of Gilgamesh, there's been pottery found. Of course, there's architecture that's been uncovered. There's been jewelry, and all of that is art. Art isn't always just like paintings. Art can be depicted in all kinds of different ways. So, you know, another thing that I always say is history is not necessarily set in stone, especially when you go this far back. History is always up for interpretation, but there's more and more history coming to light the better our technology gets. And in the mid-1990s, a site in Turkey known as Göbekli Tepe was uncovered that actually dates back several thousand years prior to the Sumerians, when, you know, mainstream history has told us we were still roaming around hunter gathering. And so this is just a clip. I know it's from Ancient Aliens and that's kind of a ridiculous show on History Channel, but this is actually a really great little clip that just explains the site of Göbekli Tepe well. So those of you online, we're watching this in class, and I will upload the PowerPoint so that you can watch it along with the Why Study History video at the very beginning of the PowerPoint. So cool video to watch about Göbekli Tepe. So how do you go from a city-state to an empire? Well, again, it's very simple yet again. Land, territory, conquering. All throughout history, you know, our history is just the rise and fall of empires. That's all you're studying. It's just, oh, this one came up and it went down. Oh, then this one came back up and then it went down. And so, you know, an empire is just, like it says, a large political unit, usually under a single leader, especially at this time in history, that controls a large territory, a large amount of people. And as it says, they're often easy to create because you're strong and you're conquering the weak, but eventually they can be hard to control because if you get so big that you have this vast amount of territory that you're trying to keep track of, then you become weak in certain spots and have more susceptibility to being taken over. So we talked about the Sumerians. Well, who took them over? The Akkadians. they conquered the Sumerians, because the Sumerians were always fighting amongst each other, and that doesn't lead to great unity and strength. So the Akkadians came in and took advantage of that and really built a huge empire, like history's first pretty major empire. Not the biggest, don't get me wrong, but like definitely one of the first ones to go, ooh. And so who did that? Their most influential king, Sargon. So Akkadian, the Akkadians lasted about 150 years, but Sargon's heirs kind of screwed everything up. When that kind of happens, you can have a really strong leader and then the heirs end up messing it up because they're kind of spoiled and they don't lead well. It's like they didn't, you know, okay, you inherited it, you didn't earn it type of thing. That tends to start happening as you get further along in an empire. But it lasted about 150 years, and then the Babylonians came and overtook the Akkadians. And their most famous leader was Hammurabi. Hammurabi is a very famous, influential historical figure because he's the first person to write down a law code. Okay, Hammurabi's code is hugely important to history because it influences all the law codes that come after it. Now, does that mean prior to Hammurabi, everybody was just running around in like a lawless chaos? No, of course not. The biggest difference is he wrote it down. So it stands the test of time, makes its way into those history books. Okay, so the Code of Hammurabi is actually incredibly interesting. There's 282 laws and it's pretty severe. You really didn't want to mess up in Babylon under the Code of Hammurabi. Lots of it is like, you do this, you'll be put to death. You do that, you'll be put to death. One of the things I read, one of the codes of law that I read out of Hammurabi's code that's always stuck with me is it's like if a wall of your house or the roof of your house caves in and like kills somebody accidentally, obviously this is like kind of a freak thing, or I don't know, maybe it wasn't, then the home builder is put to death and his family is then forced to rebuild. The family who's, you know, had the problems, they have to, the home builder's family has to rebuild their house. And I've always wondered, like, how many times did that happen? So all kinds of very specific and pretty harsh laws, like as far as punishment goes. So, you know, the old saying, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, that actually comes from Hammurabi's code. So this whole, you know, whatever you do to someone else, if it's bad, then you expect that same badness to come back at you. That was very, very much the case in Hammurabi's code. It was an eye for an eye. So this is what we're ending on Wednesday, August 19th. We're ending with this fun video. I know a lot of students in class are like, oh my gosh, it was Latham. But I promise you'll never forget where the Euphrates River is. And I have a special student up in heaven that loved these songs and loved showing these. I will never not show them. And so I hope you enjoy them. This is where we're ending again for Wednesday, August 19th, and I'll see you guys tomorrow. Don't forget to watch the video and take your notes online, kids. Those Google Doc notes, don't be forgetting. See you later.